The presenters to please come forward and take their seats. Can you guys hear anything fine? How about this one? This one work just as well? You can hear up there? Okay. Aloha. Come on. Aloha. Welcome to sunny downtown Honolulu. The show is done. Who do we seem to be missing here? Ken. Ken. You might as well sit down there if you'd like to. Come on up and say hello. Anyway, everybody, welcome to PTC and the Submarine Cable Workshop. Thank you so much for everybody attending. Today, I really hope that we blow you away with another bullet train of submarine cable activity. So it's wonderful to be here. It's wonderful to be having such a fantastic community of people to work with. And I sincerely hope you all have an extremely successful 2017. As you can see, we've got a fairly good lineup here, and it's going to be followed later on by part two with Elaine and the team. And then we've got a wonderful luncheon come up again, and hopefully this time we won't make as much noise while we're eating, because I think we all use plastic knives and forks. So thanks so much, everybody. Without too much further to do, what I'd like to do is just each person I'll just introduce. For example, Wayne Nielsen, president and publisher of Submarine Television. He's going to come up and give us a rundown on the region. So we're going to run you around the world, as we normally do, give you a bit of an update on what's going on, where it's going on, and perhaps why it's going on. After that, we'll have a couple of updates. One wonderful camp person, and then another magnificent update on where we're going with suboptic. So what I'd like to do is call Wayne to the microphone and get this show on the road.
Paul asked me to come back and talk a little bit about the Atlantic, so here I am. I'm going to talk a little about what's been going on, where things seem to be going, and a whole lot of question marks we have. So, good morning, everybody. So, looking at the transatlantic, we've got 13 current systems. Five systems are planned, probably more than that, actually, but five you can put a name to. There are new cables that are being proposed, and there's four good reasons. We're looking at new routing, looking at the mid-Atlantic to Europe, South America to Europe. Bandwidth requirements are outpacing upgrades. Lots of interesting infrastructure requirements from the OTTs, and system age in the Atlantic, certainly the North Atlantic, is a an issue. So lots of interesting activity going on. Currently, the average systems in the Atlantic, North Atlantic specifically, are about 10,500 kilometers long on average. And it's been similar routing between the U.S. and Europe really over the last 150 plus years, going back to the telegraphic cables. It's only in the last couple of years that's with plans going on, that's starting to change. If you look at the rollout of systems back to the 90s, mid-90s, we had 2 1 year, two back in 99, two in 2000, four in 2001, and then it started petering off in 2003. And really, there was a stop of any new transatlantic across the north between 2004 and 2014. This is all old history for everybody. 2015, 2016, things started changing again. And we had, in 2015, Hibernia Express went in, 2016, AE Com, or AE Connect went in. So, interesting new things. Looking at upgrades, the Atlantic, North Atlantic especially, is the world's highest capacity cable route. Between 2011 and 2016, the total available capacity increased about 240%. Big number. 100% of those systems are 40G, 85%. And looking at lit capacity, it's been a fairly steady capacity growth in the Atlantic. We're looking at fairly regular upgrades year after year. The average global lit capacity is about 17% in the Atlantic for 2014, 2016. We're looking at about 20, 21% respectively. There is a new push. It's not even, it's probably old to say, it's not a new push anymore. There's certainly a push from the OTTs driving a lot of the growth that's going on. And the Atlantic still represents the highest traffic route in the world. So let's talk about recently added systems. I mentioned Hibernia Express in 2015. In 2016, you had AE Connect come online, and it's touted as the most secure transatlantic cable in existence. Its system length of about 5,500 kilometers, uses 100G technology, and right out of the box, total capacity of around 78 there. It's the highest capacity along the transatlantic route. It actually increased the transatlantic capacity by some 34% when it went in. Big cable. Resilience. About 75% of all the current cables are along the northern route, the New York, New Jersey to Europe. But we've had some interesting DDoS attacks, which has certainly highlighted the need for alternative routing. Concurrently, you have the rise of Ashburn, Virginia data centers. I live nearby. You look at these monster farms that are just these big white buildings as you drive by. There's also a demand for diversifying from the New York, New Jersey corridor to other areas. And the idea is to get to Ashburn that much faster. So let's talk about planned systems. In the south, we've got two systems that are looking to go from South America to Africa. In the north, we have two systems that are talking about going from Europe to the Middle Atlantic or Mid-Atlantic region of the U.S. And then there's a Brazil to Europe system in the various states. With all these systems potentially going in, there's a considerable jump in the number of systems from 2017 and beyond. Depending on how you count, you can count five systems that are possible. Maybe that number's higher if you consider others. Probably one to two, maybe more, are very likely. And the focus of these systems is primarily on new routing, new areas, not going just across the north. So what's the status? Well, of the five systems, one is CIF. The new routes, we think, are going to be heavily competitive when they do go in. The question then is, if route, is there room for another cable in short order? And really, are you in a position where the first one to the bank wins? So let's talk about the Mid-Atlantic to Europe. There are two cable systems that are being talked about. There are more cable systems being talked about. I'm going to talk about two, Maria and Midgard-Sormen. Both of those systems are addressing their desire to get to the Virginia, Ashburn, Virginia data centers. They're going up in the Jersey area. They're basically coming down to Virginia Beach. And the idea is that they're going to create a geographic diversity from that New York, New Jersey hub. Looking at Brazil to Europe, you've got Eulalink. And it's really addressing the cable's desire to connect to the internet. They're currently connecting to the internet through the U.S., so it's reducing their dependency on that. And it allows them to host global data centers for their heavy users. And as they say, it's agile communications with Europe. Bouncing around to South America, to Africa, you've got SACS, you've got Cameroon, Brazil. There are other systems that are being talked about. There are no direct cons between South America and Africa, so these systems would be addressing those holes. The idea is that it would reduce African dependence on European hubs, and it would connect two regions that are emerging. So let's talk positive first. In the past, the transatlantic systems utilized similar paths, the Europe to New York, New Jersey kind of a path. So now we're looking at a diversity push, which is putting together an interesting and potentially strong business case by going south to the Mid-Atlantic. And I'm talking specifically about North Atlantic systems here. So by going into the Mid-Atlantic, it simplifies your connections through Virginia Beach to Ashburn. And in so doing, you're creating an enhanced resilience between Europe and the U.S. There's also a trend that the OTTs are getting more and more involved in cable builds. And that's a really good thing in a couple of ways. One is you've got a nice guaranteed infrastructure demand. They can look forward and have a pretty good idea of what their demand needs are going to be, and they've got money in the bank. That's always a good thing. And quite honestly, the OTTs are firmly entrenched in daily business and personal life. They're not going to go away anytime soon. They're there. They're here to stay. Let's talk about concerns in the Atlantic. And I'm talking again about the North Atlantic. If you discount the two newest systems, AE Connect and Hibernia Express, the average age of cables now across the North Atlantic is about 16 years. And of those cables, they're running out of upgrade paths. And the question is, what more can you squeeze out of them in the future? I'm talking about the older cables. Also, business cases. Looking at new cables, there's potentially room for maybe only one system per new route. There's potentially a low amount of traffic along some of these routes that are also being considered. And I'm talking now about South America to Africa. Maybe those markets have to grow a little bit more. And what's interesting is as of the end of last year, the CIF rate for new systems, and I'm talking North Atlantic, were about 20%. So it's actually pretty low. That could change tomorrow, mind you. Also, got concerns about pricing. Pricing across the Atlantic is continuing to go downward, which is a good thing in some ways and not depending on where you are in the mix. But if you have a flood of new systems, are we potentially then getting into a price crashing kind of situation? I'm not raising a red flag. I'm just saying those are the concerns one might have. Talking about future-proofing, how much can you squeeze out of the new systems going in with future upgrades? And the answer is I don't know the answer to that. There are probably people in this room that can answer that quite nicely. Are the new systems going to be eligible for 400G and whatever comes beyond? And we're talking about, when we're talking about new systems and future bandwidth demands, we're talking about more fiber pairs and higher system costs and so on. And then, of course, the big concern of an overbuild. Are we there, or are we potentially going in that direction? Now, we know that for the next few years, the planned systems are going to be basically doubling the existing capacity in the Atlantic. And if you look at Marea specifically, which is in implementation, it's a 160 terabit system, and it's basically half of the existing capacity all by itself. And without Marea, you've got an average of about 64 terabits. So even if you have two or three under service, we're looking at capacity increasing in the Atlantic something around the 33 to 50% mark. Now, I'm a student of Adam Smith, like everybody, and it's interesting that we have increasing supply, increasing demand, and whether they're increasing at the same rates or not, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. If they are, then we have a lovely equilibrium, and prices, you know, may decline, but it's not going to crash. If they're out of equilibrium and supply is increasing at a rate which is much higher than demand, then price will come down, as we all know. There's also some recent concerns about, or concerns about recent finance history. AEConnect has refinanced a couple of times in the last year. Their system is just a year old now. Hibernia was just sold. Hibernia Networks was just sold. These could be really positive things. Or not. New system driver trends. Well, the reality is, in a positive way, the OTTs are driving a lot of cables around the area, around the region, and around the world, for that matter. The question is, for how long? Their appetite right now is significant. God bless them. They're wonderful. But for how long are they going to have this appetite? How long will they need more and more and more fiber? They're in a wonderful place. They have the ability today to negotiate really tough contracts to their benefit. And I suppose in an interesting way, they're in a kind of a take-it-or-leave-it mentality. They can drive the market in ways that few other companies can do. It's an envious role. And at the end of the day, they can lock themselves into long, marginally profitable contracts on new systems. It's a great place to be. So, are there any warning signs out there in the Atlantic? Well, one might be, and I stress might, that we are looking at a similar pattern of overbuild and financial dealings that we saw 15 years ago. And in the worst case, it could end up being an industry crash or certainly a regional crash. And I'm not saying that's where we're headed. I'm saying those are just possible signs. We're also seeing a spate of bankruptcies that have come about. We're seeing sales and mergers, which can be a positive thing or negative depending on the circumstances. But they could be potential red flags for the overall industry health. And if we go back in history, it all started before with the Atlantic. So here's my closing thought, and I'll quote the industry report from a couple of months ago. Right now, we are in some of the busiest times we've been in a generation. It's a wonderful time to be a supplier, a consultant. It's a wonderful time to be in this business. But looking forward, it's as if we're standing looking at fog. We can see where we're going to be in a year, maybe two, but beyond that, it's kind of tough to see. That doesn't mean it's necessarily bad. It doesn't mean we're necessarily standing at the edge of a precipice. It means we don't necessarily know exactly where we're going to be in the next 3+ years. So a lot can change. Thank you.
What a great way to start, by scaring the pants off everybody. Where do you want to go to next? It's your call. Anybody want to go to, what do you reckon? We haven't had LATAM for a long, long time. Come and tell us what's going on. So I'd like you to welcome Eric, CEO of GlobeNet. And we'll get to come up and fill us in on what's going on in that region of the world. Now, I just wanted to say as well, we're not trying to, if we haven't talked about your cable during the course of this, sorry. Because we're not trying to talk about every cable. We're trying to give you an indication of what's going on and why. So without further ado, I'll get Eric to come up and tell us about the Latin and Caribbean area.
Good morning, everybody. So let's talk briefly about Latin America and the Caribbean. So the first question, it's more of a quiz, is where's the main connectivity hub for LATAM? Where do things happen in our market? Well, it's Miami. So most systems and most of the traffic that we actually see going into Latin America, this is a historic reason, actually occurs there. Despite the fact that things have shifted a little bit, we've seen traffic into New York for a long time. There's some new system builds going into Virginia Beach for the same reasons that Wayne mentioned, that they want to get closer to Ashburn. But the fact is that the majority of Latin America actually happens in Miami. And a lot of that had to do with the fact that the countries were not interconnected. So before the entire craze of system build happened in the early 2000s, I remember living at that time in Venezuela, and in order to send one email from one ISP to the other, you had to go through Miami, because there was no interconnection between the countries, and they just stayed there. So if you wanted to have your web page hosted, you did it in Miami. You didn't do it in your country. And that has been changing. So stealing a little bit of info from telegeography, it kind of gives you a sense for what the traffic looked like in our region. And it's been consistently growing over the last 10 years. I mean, we've had about a 40% year-over-year growth of traffic. And one of the things that we're just now starting to see over the last couple of years is the construction of large-scale data centers in Brazil, some in Colombia, and in other geographies. Google actually is leading or has built a large data center in Chile. And we're starting to see some amount of inter-country communication that in the past we didn't see. But still, most of the content is actually hosted or is cached or comes from the United States. Different perhaps from what we see in other geographies like Europe, where there's quite a bit of balance, let's say, between the two ends of a cable. Now, Latin America has gone through a very interesting trend. It turns to, you know, it starts going great, 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 and then it fizzles. So you need to have, in many cases, deep pockets, and you need to have a long-term outlook when you're looking at your businesses in the region. When some of the projects were put in place in order to build systems into Latin America a couple of years back, and we all know that it takes 3 to 5 years even more to build a new subsea cable system, the economies looked better. They looked better everywhere. Every single country had a very positive uptrend. And what we saw in 2016 is actually a very negative economic outlook. And it's starting to get better. So the news is 2016 is done. I remember when we were working on our budgets, we were looking at the annual growth, let's say, of the largest country in Latin America, which was Brazil. We started out in 2015 by thinking, well, it's going to grow 4%. Well, for a country that's in development, that's bad news. Because typically a country in development has a growth rate of 8% or a little bit more. When you start to see half the growth is bad. As we got closer to the end of 2015, we were talking about 2% growth. And when we started 2016, we were looking at 2% negative. But that's not a great, let's say it's not a great indication. And we saw that the similar thing happened in Chile and Argentina and Colombia, and pretty much all those countries were hit by the crash of the oil price. Now, where we are today is we can say that 2016 in most areas bottomed out, and we're starting to see a slow positive growth from an economic perspective. You can see that the largest countries are hovering somewhere in the neighborhood of 2%. Brazil is, you know, not even 1. It's quite stable. And you look at the growth rate, you say, well, if things don't look that rosy, then why are we building? But let me show you the data from a slight different perspective. The number of subscribers is growing in Latin America because the penetration is very low. It's still very, very low. So you have more disposable income. You have networks that were not built out back then, so cellular is really taken off, mobility, smartphones, etc. Many people have more than one device. And the average consumption per user is also going up. So all these are phenomenal trends with respect to our particular industry, because you have to serve all those millions of users. So you have the doubling of that effect, and of course everything is driven by the social media applications, web scale companies, and so on that Neil talked about. Going back a little bit in history, this is what the map looked like in 2002. I'm not showing the Caribbean here, but back then you basically had some very old consortia cable. And these were, let's say, the modern cables at the time. And into Latin America, you had three cables, Global Crossings cable, the Telefonica cable, and then GlobeNet, which was the last one to be built. And when these systems were designed, they were designed in such a way that you wanted to touch, let's say, those geographies that had the largest growth. So if 360 would have not gone under, GlobeNet would have had a third leg into Argentina, because that's the way they were designed, almost like a little daisy chain. Not as bad as the festoon, but you were trying to touch the most important countries. If you fast forward and you look at 2016, 17, and even 2018, that's what the telegeography map looks like. And you're going to see that there's a series of systems, and a lot of them actually coming into market. So there's a couple of questions that you need to ask yourself. The first one is, well, if Wayne says that about 17% utilization of existing systems, you see about 20 in, let's say, in our space or less, then why are new systems being built? Well, it has to do with several factors. One is routes. So you're going to go after a separate route. The second one is that most systems that are being built are express systems. So you don't want to do that daisy chain effect. You want to go to the largest market, the shortest distance, the fastest cable. And the other thing that you also look at is the upgrade capability. In an express system, you basically have two pieces of kit, one on each side of the cable. If you have a system like the ones that were built in 2002, you have many segments, which means it's upgraded systems in the cost, perhaps a little bit more. And then you need to look at, well, what happens beyond 2018? If it takes us 3 to 5 years to build a new system, and you're going to need more, then what's going to happen in 2020, 21, 2022? And there's several reasons why some of these systems are being deployed. So we went from basically nothing. We had a couple of systems in the Caribbean that were built. But into Latin America, we had until 2014, when the Mexicans built a private cable, AMX1. Pretty soon thereafter, we had the resurgence of a basically consortium system, the Pacific Caribbean cable system. That connects Ecuador with Panama, then up through the Caribbean into Miami. And now you're going to have, going forward, on the U.S.-Brazil route, you're going to have Seabrush 1, supposed to be done by June 2017. You're going to have Monet, consortium cable between Google and Dell, Algar, and Angola Cables. You're going to have Canat, connecting basically the Monet system in Brazil down to Argentina, or Uruguay, actually. And you have Junior, which is an OTT-led cable connecting Rio and Sao Paulo. That's all 2017. In that particular route, US to Brazil, you're going to have a huge amount of competition, brand new systems that are coming into the market. And at least in 2018, when the next monster cable comes in, an 8-5 repair system owned by Telefonica, Brusa, Brazil, USA, that one lands in Virginia Beach. So you're starting to see what Wayne described in his presentation earlier. Some people are looking at replacing same routes. Some are looking at new routes. And some are actually saying, I want to get to where the action is in a more effective or more cost-effective way. Then you have two systems that we know are under construction. So SACS, that's the Angola cable system connecting Brazil with Angola. And then you have SAIL, which is a China Unicom / Camtel that connects Africa with Brazil. Now, we know that those are under construction. And then, of course, there's Eulalink and there's a bunch of others. And you have to ask yourself, systems being built, in particular these over here. I mean, there's a connection between developing countries. That's great. It's going to take a long time to fill them up. In the case of Angola cables, they have the view that if they connect Latin America with Africa, and then they connect the west coast of Africa, either terrestrially or through another means, to the east coast, you can pick up Asia traffic. And then that's going to come through SACS and eventually to Brazil and then up to the United States. So again, it has to do with route. But there's also a lot of governments that want to get involved. I remember back in, I don't know, probably 5 years ago, President Dilma at the time in Brazil announced that they're going to build 6 cables. So there's a lot of pride. They want to bypass the U.S. They want to show that they're actually bringing the internet to the people and so on. The reality is that out of the 6 cables that the Brazilian government announced, probably none are going to be built, right? Because it's very difficult to make a business case in order to justify the construction of these systems. What's the other trend? Not different perhaps from what we see, let's say, along the Atlantic route, is the fact that you're seeing a huge price decline in our markets and the tendencies to continue to go. If you have 3 new systems coming into the US-Brazil route, you can guarantee that price will continue to fall. The initial projections that we had from telegeography here, actually at Suboptic in 2012, was a price decline of approximately 15% per year. And the projection for 2016 was in the order of 20 or so percent. What we ended up seeing was a 45% price decline. That is huge. And that was driven by several things. It was driven by hype. Oh, there's new systems coming in, so therefore I'm going to get a better price. It was driven that by the fact that 100 gig technology was available, so you could transfer part of your savings that you got in from the technology over to the user. And we started to see a big spike of demand that we hadn't seen in previous years. So the combination of both things created huge pricing pressures, in particular on the route US to Brazil. I don't see that route recovering that fast. Matter of fact, the question mark for all of those that are in the space, it's going to be crowded for a couple of years. So we better tighten our belts. We better take a look at what's happening in the market. And then hopefully people will make sound business decisions, because what you don't want to see on the US-Latin America route is what we had in the Atlantic in 2002. So I think as executives of companies, we need to think very carefully, you know, what steps we need to take, and hopefully we won't do any irrational moves in our space. So this talks a little bit about utilization. So I mentioned that before. We see the same thing. Most of our systems, of the existing systems, have no more than 20% utilization. And then you start to look at, well, what do the projections look like? So I stole another slide from telegeography. This is the end of 2015. And what they were doing is they looked at the curve and they said, let me take all the existing systems, and under the assumption that they can be upgraded with 100 gig technology, at what point do we run out of capacity? And then they said, if one more system gets built, at what point does that system run out of capacity? And so on. And so you start to see a curve that, let's say, by 2023, more or less, unless new systems are built, you cannot upgrade, let's say, your capacity, or you cannot serve the demand that they expect to have in that particular region. Now, the other question that you need to ask yourselves is, if the growth that is projected is about 40% per year, that is actually a very cool number. I want to be riding that 40% year growth. But then you need to ask yourselves, out of that 40% year growth, how much of that is actually OTT growth that's going to be on their own private networks? Because OTTs are enabling system builds. And by the way, the trend is for everything to be open systems or dark systems, right? So you're selling increments of fiber pairs, not of E1s. How much of that growth is going to be on the networks of the Googles, the Facebooks, the Amazons, the Microsoft, and so on? And so you can more or less estimate that about 70% of that growth is going to be in a private network. And so what that means is that only 30% is truly addressable market for the traditional international wholesale providers. And I tend to believe that that ratio is very similar in the other geographies outside of Latin America. So it's going to be definitely interesting over the next several years. So to sum this up, the U.S. still continues to be the main hub. We're starting to see some internet exchanges being developed, and we're also starting to see some inter-country communication that just didn't exist. Somebody in Colombia is not as interested in seeing Brazilian content unless it has to do with soccer. OTTs are driving demand and definitely enabling new builds. So that tends to be a common trend. I think from an economic perspective in Latin America, things are going in the right direction. I think that's definitely a good sign. Prices continue to erode. So let's, tighten your belt. And I think that there are going to be additional developments in the space over the next several years, because demand will continue to grow. Thank you very much.
Wow, thanks, Eric. That was very perfect to follow on with. Talking about perfect, I want to welcome Loic. Loic, if you would, please. I'm going to finish up. Sorry, Jonathan. I think we'll finish with the prime region. But that's only because I'm biased. Loic LaFerse from Axiom. Loic is, I think it's the first time you've been...
Yeah, I'm the rookie here.
Yeah, you're the rookie. All right. But I think you'll... Where is it? Owner and co-founder of Axiom, huh? Well done. Make him welcome.
On notice,
short notice. Thank you very much, Loic.
Thank you, Pete, for inviting me. Paul, for inviting me. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm probably not the first one. I'll probably not be the last one to wish you a happy new year. I've been asked by Paul somewhere in December to come over and do a presentation of what has been changing in the European, Middle East, and African region in terms of submarine cables. So that's what we're going to do now. Going to try to keep within the small timing. So let's go to the Europe first. Well, Europe has, over the last years, and 2016 is not an exception to that, has been a very low construction market for submarine cables. We have seen only one new build, really, the Sea Lion cable between Finland and Germany, and that's a system, and the name OTT, or the word OTT, is going to be something you will hear around the table quite a lot. That's a system that is probably driven by OTT needs. Also, the only projects that have come around in Europe recently are projects that are linked to the fact that Ireland is becoming one of the entry points for the Atlantic cables, and Ireland is an island and it needs to be connected to the continent. And two projects have been discussed recently, which are PPP and IFC1. To my knowledge, none of these projects have materialized at this stage. If we go down south in that very specific region, which is MEA, which is quite made of different regions actually, the Mediterranean Sea, this region has historically been served by big European to Asia highways, the CME we like, including EIG, etc., MEU. And in those, in the Med Sea, those systems had branches to many of the coastal countries. The two new systems that have come around, CMEV5 that entered into service last month, and AE1 that is expected to be in service shortly, have continued that tradition with some landing points all over the all over Mediterranean, but essentially in the north, probably for security reasons. So the only regional systems that have appeared or regional projects that have appeared in that region are basically the leftovers, and one of them is Algeria to Spain with the Orval system. There are projects also discussed out of Libya and out of Syria. Unfortunately, those projects are not coming at a fast pace for clear instability, political instability in both countries and security issues. But basically, those are the leftovers from the CMEVs and like. If we move down to Africa and let's say West Africa first, and if we look at the continental or intercontinental cables first, the route between West Africa and South Africa up to Europe has been quite active over the last decades with new systems. Four systems have been built: the WAC system, the ACE system, Main One, and Glow One. They are serving most of the coastal countries of West Africa. This route is still very active. The ACE system is still under extension to go down to South Africa. The WAX and ACE systems have been upgraded recently. And even the SAT-3 system, which is the old, more than 15 years old system in the region, has been recently upgraded. I think it was signed later this year, last year. Because of the bandwidth availability of the system, those are quite huge systems, maybe not the same as the transatlantic systems we discussed, but they are quite significant for the region. Because of the connectivity they provide, most of the countries are served, and most are served more than one time. And because of the competition between these systems, the price is quite satisfactory. And therefore, we don't see any new system on that route for the short term. As mentioned, I'm sorry, I'm the third one to discuss about the new routes between Africa and South America. Basically, we see these new routes as a demand from Africa to go quickly to the US and not depend on upon the European market or the European ports. And basically, two systems are under constructions, we understand. This one is Angola to Brazil, the SACS system by Angola Cable. And the other one is the SAIR system between Cameroon and Brazil, done by HMN. The last one to mention, which is in a way a system between Brazil and Africa, because it lands in Canary Islands, is Eulalink. But to be completely honest, this system is more a system between Europe and Brazil to avoid going to the US. And it's more like the old Atlantis II system that was done. But to my knowledge, in the optical era, we've never seen some systems going from Africa to South America. So it's a new deal. Huh? It's a new deal. Maybe just to mention regional cables in that region, the Cameroon to Nigeria cable. I mentioned this one because it's been done by, let's say, a newcomer in the industry, HMN. So we're going to see it's not their first project, but it's one of the first ones. So we need to see what will happen. And to mention that they're going to do also the Cameroon to Brazil, which is a much longer one. So welcome to the newcomers and good luck. If we go and move to the east of the continent, let me put all those systems on. This part of Africa basically was didn't know any optical submarine cables up to 2008. From 2008 to 2010, this region was beat, and three systems were put into the in the water almost together, linking most of the countries in the areas. In the area, and those are the EC, SECOM, and TEAM system. And everything was done in 2010, and since then, nothing happens. A few upgrades, EC was upgraded or signed an upgrade last year. All of them went through upgrades, but no new builds. So it's quite a long period, except for the Atlantic. There's not been a lot of areas where we've not seen any builds for six or 7 years. And that's probably the reason why over the last 1 or 2 years, we've seen many new projects on the same route. I've listed five of them, which are probably the five most important ones. The first one is there. It's a consortium cable that is led by Djibouti Telecom. It goes from Djibouti to Kenya, linking Somalia, which is always a difficult part of the world to connect, and also Yemen. We've got the O2C system, which is very similar on the same route, but that is private. And then we've got three cables that are huge cables, even bigger than transatlantic or alike, which are systems that goes from the south end of Africa to the north end of Africa and have some extension to Indian Ocean and Middle East. And those are the Mercury system led by Vodafone, Liquid Sea, which is a project promoted by Liquid Telecom, and the Africa one, which was announced in Suboptic last year, and that is a consortium with big players outside the region and within the region, TSA, PCCW, and STC. To be completely honest, and I've been involved in the old EC and making the business plan of EC, the region is quite poor. It has a demand that is quite limited compared to what we can see in other parts of the world. And it would be very, very, very strange to see more than one or two cables on that route again. The old cables still have cables like EC is largely upgradable still, and it would be very, very strange to see more than one or two cables again. Huh? But as mentioned, overbuilt has existed in other parts of the world in other times, so no one knows. In a similar way that we had a new route on the west going to South America, there is a development of a new route, or at least one cable, one project is trying to develop a new route from the East Africa. And that's the AWE project that goes from Djibouti to Perth, Australia. But to our knowledge, this cable has not been very active over the 2016 year. So we'll see if this route happens. Just to mention regional cables in the region, there was one system that was announced quite a long ago, and that was a G2A system that's linking Oman to Somalia, two points in the north of Somalia in the Gulf of Aden. This system, to our knowledge, is a little bit on hold because its supplier went under quite difficult financial issues. Finally, on that region, to mention a few regional cable, there are two or three initiatives in the some of the islands, or to provide additional connectivity to some islands, essentially Mauritius. One of the projects is IOX, another one is Métis. Those two projects have not been materialized as we speak, but they are under discussion, and they could well appear in 2017. And let me just finish with the last part of the region, and that's an easy one too. Basically, the Middle East, as for Mediterranean Sea, the Middle East has benefited from the Europe to Asia big, huge cables, and most of the connectivity in that region has been made through those CMIWI type. It is the same with the two new systems, CMIWI 5 and AE1, CMIWI 5 being already completed. We do believe that because of the amount of capacity that those two systems are bringing to the region, which is huge for the region, there is no reason, and we don't see any projects coming on in that region in the short term. And no regional cable either. I've tried to be short, a little bit less, a little bit more descriptive than the others, but hopefully you have a good view on the region. Thanks.
Thank you. Marek, thank you very, very much. I was quite astounded to see so many landings. It's like a consultant's dream with all those landings all the way down the West Coast. Next up, I'd like to ask Jonathan. Jonathan Kriegel is the CEO of NTT Docomo Pacific. Could you please make Jonathan welcome? Jonathan is going to cover off on the Asia Pacific region. As soon as I get it up. Isn't it great technology, eh?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Jonathan Kriegel, as Paul said. I'm the CEO of Docomo Pacific, and I think I really am the newcomer to the industry. Docomo Pacific is building its first repeaterless submarine cable, which hopefully will go into service later this year. So I was honored when Paul asked me to speak, but also a little bit daunted, but we'll give it our best effort. So in the Asia Pacific and Oceania regions, we wanted to talk a little bit about growth in traffic. That's a real concern for everyone. We obviously want to cover Trans-Pacific cables, but also regional systems, and talk a little bit about what's driving growth in the systems in the South Pacific, in the small island nations. In terms of bandwidth in the Pacific region, like the rest of the world, Moore's Law, lower price for the systems themselves, is driving the availability of bandwidth, and we see a pretty dramatic increase in bandwidth over the coming years. But similarly, and I've heard this figure mentioned already in other regions, we are seeing strong 40% compounded annual growth rates in demand on these new systems that are coming in. So for the time being, it looks like at a high level, and certainly on the major routes, that the demand will keep up with capacity, and the new systems that are going in will in fact be utilized. In terms of traffic trends, from Oceania, most of the traffic continues to find its way to North America. But interestingly, in recent years, we've been seeing the traffic in Asia, in Southeast Asia, is staying in the region. So the Asia-Pacific region creating its own demand. I think you'll see that with all of the regional system construction, that this supports And I think we'll see continue to see a further trend of growth of traffic that stays within the Asia-Pacific region. On the trans-Pacific routes, similar to the other regions in the world, the OTT players are in fact driving investment in many of the new systems that are going into place. Certainly Google is the major driver behind Faster, which went into service in 2016. And that you can see that in recent years, the private networks driven by the OTT players now really account for approximately a third of lit demand across the Pacific. And interestingly, this chart talks about primarily the North American OTT players, and they've really been driving demand and investments in the systems up until this point. I think that when we look sort of 3-4 years into the future, I expect to see a lot of the Asian OTT players, Alibaba and others, also following a similar strategy. So, big region to cover, growth on the north, growth on the Trans-Pacific region, growth in Southeast Asia, South and Southeast Asia, and growth in the South Pacific. We'll try and divide the region into two. On the Trans-Pacific routes, as I mentioned before, the Faster cable came online in 2016. New Cross-Pacific, which Microsoft is leading, comes online in 2017, and Pacific Light, which Google and Facebook are investing in, comes on in 2018. And then, of course, CUS is expected to come online early in the middle of this year. So that is four new systems cross-Pacific. My understanding from all the industry experts is that we haven't seen this kind of construction in really 15 years. Of course, China-US has been decommissioned, so there is some amount of replacement capacity, but fundamentally, given the advances in electronics and system capacities, these four systems provide far more bandwidth and new capacity than certainly is being replaced by China-US and should meet demand going forward. What's driving this many systems? Route diversity. I understand that the OTT players seek at least three routes on all of these, or three paths on all of these major routes. So that's certainly driving it. I think demand for digital content all over Asia, mobile telephony, the internet. You have massive economies in Southeast Asia, many countries with over 100 million people, obviously China. So the fundamentals feel like they're in place to support this kind of demand. And obviously, New Southern Cross, Hawaii, and others coming up from Oceania. In Asia, North Asia, Southeast Asia, the South Pacific, many new regional systems. You can see in red the number of systems that were turned up in 2016. Loic mentioned CMIWI 5 and AAE1 providing capacity between Southeast Asia and Europe. Regional systems MYTHIC and MCT really connecting the Myanmar, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and then many smaller systems in the South Pacific as well. We have the Yap and Palau spurs to CUS, which will come online later this year, and Docomo Pacific's Batisa cable, which will connect the hub in Guam to the Northern Marianas and is the first new system on that route in approximately 20 years. So lots of activity going on, and you can see that a lot of these smaller regional systems connecting to the hubs in the hubs then connecting to the bigger Trans-Pacific systems. In the South Pacific, these systems, which are obviously with the lower prices of electronics and these economies seeking faster access to bandwidth, replacing higher price satellite, but this growth would not be possible without funding from the multilateral. So although Dogma Pacific system is self-funded, most of the other systems that are coming online in the South Pacific are really due to the funding from the World Bank and ADB. So, just in terms of summarizing quickly what's going on in our region, we talked about the large Trans-Pacific systems and the demand from the OTT players. As I mentioned before, we expect to see the Asian-based OTT players also seeking their own systems in the future. That might create an issue around overcapacity, but at the moment we don't see it. The Pacific Island nations continue to grow with funding from multilaterals. That continues to look like an area of opportunity for those smaller nations to connect into the bigger systems. And then the hubbing opportunities, if you look at what's happening in Guam, the number of new systems that are coming in there and into Hawaii, real opportunities in those markets as well. So I have not tried to provide, as Paul mentioned, an exhaustive list of all the new systems that are being built. I think there are over 20 that are being discussed. Our slides are going to be available, and at the end we've got a nice table that we've constructed with a detailed list of all of those things if you're interested in the specifics. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So that's around the world in 1 hour and 2 minutes, which wasn't too bad. And I thank you guys. That's a lot of work to do for us all. But your expertise and your knowledge of each of your particular regions is really, really appreciated. So can we just thank the regional guys? Next up, I'd like to call Kent Bressing up, please. I think Kent is very well known to us all. Much loved, always entertaining. And like the others, their bios are actually in the documentation that you've been given for the conference. So I'm not going to read it all out, but I mean, I think Kent is well known around the world. Over to you, mate.
Thank you, Paul. Good morning, everybody. Yet again, we keep getting bigger rooms for this workshop, and we have maxed out space, and it's standing room only again. So thanks for being here on a Sunday morning. We are going to, in the next 15 minutes, take a quick tour of some regulatory developments in the Pacific region, largely U.S.-centric, given traffic flows, but touching on additional developments outside the United States. In particular, I want to talk about what's going on with the Team Telecom national security reviews that everyone dreads. Increasing conflicts over surveillance and law enforcement activities. That is not an issue that is unique to the United States, although U.S. activities seem to get the most press. The impact of the presidential election and FCC activities as a consequence, and then new extraterritorial marine protected areas and national marine sanctuaries. Yep. So, by the end of this week, we'll have a new president sworn in the United States. There has been a lot of speculation, as there is with every change in administration, about the impact of the new president and his team on regulation and policy priorities. I would say it's reached the level of a frenzy with the election of Donald Trump. Particularly as it pertains to foreign investment and national security issues, There's just a lot of uncertainty about what this means for the national security reviews. Is it going to empower the hardliners who've always existed that are opposed to a lot of foreign investment? Or is it going to create some actual helpful disruption to a process that just becomes increasingly dysfunctional? It remains to be seen how that is actually going to play out. If you're wondering about that image, by the way, that's a pumpkin that my sister, who's an artist in San Francisco, carved for Halloween this year. In terms of the team telecom dysfunction, reviews of more than a year are now standard. The timelines are actually getting longer. It kills me to say that, but that's where we are in terms of the timing, in spite of the best efforts of the owners and their consultants and counsel. DHS, once again, is the Department of Homeland Security, is the source of much of the delay due to disorganization of different parts of DHS. And the fact that all the agencies are prioritizing other things that do have deadlines over team telecom reviews, and this just gets pushed to the bottom of the list with submarine cable reviews. The agencies also continue to view the option of getting special temporary authority for construction as a viable option. The FCC does not like this, but this ends up buying the security agencies more time. I think we're also starting to see that the team telecom process is fragmenting. Each of the three agencies, the Departments of Homeland Security, Justice, and Defense, are pursuing their own distinct policy and security priorities. And in some cases, they're insisting on having, for particular companies, their own agency-specific mitigation arrangements. And that certainly does not decrease the amount of time it takes for a review, and it increases the complexity for companies. So here, and my apologies, I think for some of you the type might be a little small, but I have a table showing where we stand with recent systems in terms of FCC and team telecom reviews. The FCC and the security agencies have never seen so many simultaneously pending systems before. At one point, there were 8 that were pending. The queue has been reduced a little bit on Thursday. Both CUS and NCP were licensed, and so they have now completed the federal licensing process in the U.S. for those systems. CUS, obviously, U.S. Southeast Asia, also connecting Guam and Hawaii, and NCP connecting Northeast Asia with Oregon. But we still have pending Atiza, Quintillion, Barossa, Moorea, and Hawaiki, and others like PLCN and New Japan US to come. And so the workflow burden for the agencies is not going to decrease, a point that we've tried to make. I think still that this is a temporary blip in terms of their workload. But the combination of that workload with political change, I think, is going to bog things down even more. So in terms of what the security agencies actually focus on, they've always been focused on equipment, but there's a lot more focus on software and contractors, OSS systems, personnel figuring out who might have electronic or physical access to networks. DHS tends to take the lead on those issues, with DOJ focusing more on concerns about surveillance and law enforcement. Those agencies' concerns, along with DOD, about Chinese equipment suppliers and services have not abated. Those issues come up in every review, as do questions about software developed or provided remotely from Russia. Query whether that is going to change with Trump's affinity for the Russian government. We've also seen DHS take much more of an interest in the actual legal arrangements among consortium members. That didn't exist before, but we're seeing requests to review CNMAs and landing party agreements in a way that didn't exist before. My cautionary note there is talk with folks who know about the Team Telecom process as you're negotiating those documents so that you don't have to amend them later on to placate the security agencies. And the other big development is just a rash of site inspections, not just for facilities in the United States, but also outside the United States, where representatives of the Department of Justice and the Department of Homeland Security want to visit cable landing stations, knock facilities, and the like. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail about that, as I know that Elaine's panel is going to address that, and my colleague Susanna Larson. So underlying a lot of the security reviews for new systems and M&A activity is just a lot of continuing tension between the industry and surveillance and law enforcement activities. And I think it's become even more acute with tech companies, who I think in some ways have been more willing to push back on government requests than traditional telecom companies have been in the past. Microsoft won a big victory in the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit, finding that U.S. laws requiring disclosure of circuit data did not extend to Microsoft's data center in Ireland and data stored there. The Justice Department has appealed that. We see a lot of activity with legislative proposals to try to streamline or clarify, modernize, or make more transparent the process for cross-border surveillance and law enforcement activity. I will note that the most recent vintage of security agreements with the Team Telecom agencies do include transparency provisions that the OTT providers have pushed for in their agreements that allow them to disclose certain things when they get particular kinds of requests from the security agencies. But as I noted, this is not just an issue in the United States. In the UK, the Investigatory Powers Act 2016 greatly expands the UK government's authority to conduct surveillance without a warrant and imposes all kinds of burdensome data storage requirements on them. The legality of this is in question in light of a subsequent ruling by the European Court of Human Rights, but I think we're going to continue to see a lot of that around the world. Again, these tend to get a lot of press with the US or UK legal systems, which are very transparent. That's not to say that other governments around the world are not conducting surveillance or hoovering up data at will. That occurs in many parts of the world. Legal systems are not set up to really provide for insight into that or challenges to it. So moving on to the impact of our election on matters at the FCC, I think it's well known that there's a desire across the board with the Trump administration and its designees to reverse or roll back many of the policies developed by the Obama administration and the relevant rules and regulations. This, in terms of the FCC, it remains to be seen if this is going to result in any progress in rolling back the ill-conceived outage reporting requirements that the FCC imposed on the industry last year. The rules have been finalized. They haven't yet taken effect. NASCA and others continue to push to limit or reverse those. And certainly the Republican commissioners continuing at the FCC have expressed great skepticism about those rules. Unfortunately, the political change seems to have stalled the efforts of the FCC to achieve Team Telecom reform. The FCC initiated a rulemaking last year proposing time limits, transparency requirements, and other data collection standardization for a process that has really started to run amok. Essentially, they ran out of time. It was supposed to be considered in terms of new rules and requirements at the FCC's December 2016 meeting, but given all the political turmoil, that item was pulled. So it's our hope that that item will be picked up by the new FCC. At least a couple of the continuing commissioners are supportive of trying to reform this process. but it's not clear if that's actually going to happen, or the pressure that they might get from the Trump administration not to impose limits on that process. So the final subject that I'm going to discuss is the continuing expansion of marine protected areas. And I think a lot of the focus in the industry in recent years has been, particularly with ICPC and concerns about activity in the Northeast Atlantic under the OSPAR Convention. But that's not the only part of the world where we see marine protected areas being developed in a way that either ignores submarine cables or actively tries to exclude them from particular ocean areas. And so in the United States, we have a couple of new national monuments, both in the Northwest Hawaiian Islands and off the eastern seaboard, east of New York and New Jersey. In Canada, we have a proposal for a new marine protected area off the Nova Scotia coast. And in Mexico, we have some huge new marine protected areas in both the Pacific and the Caribbean Sea. As currently established or proposed, these generally do not account for submarine cable installation or maintenance. There are some provisions in the National Monument Establishment for Northeast Canyons and Seamounts for submarine cables, but that does not exist for the Papahano Makuakea. Say that five times quickly. National Marine Monument, that is in the Northwest Hawaiian Islands. There was a protected area there previously established by President George W. Bush. President Obama expanded it significantly, and that expanded national monument is an area that is twice the size of that covered by the OSPAR Convention in the Northeast. And so here I'll just close with a few maps of these areas, and I'm not going to call out the specific existing or planned submarine cables, but let's just say that coming into Hawaii, the southeastern reach of the new monument here poses a particular issue for a number of systems. The rules have not yet been established for the expanded monument area, and so I believe NASCA and other industry groups and individual cable operators are going to be trying to shape those rules to make sure that they don't constrain installation and maintenance activities. Here we have the Northeast Canyons and Seamounts off the continental shelf on the seaboard of the eastern U.S. A number of systems actually thread through those seamounts. The MPA off the coast of Nova Scotia. And finally, the huge new areas that Mexico has designated. All of these raise law of the sea jurisdictional issues about the ability of coastal states to actually restrict submarine cable freedoms beyond the territorial sea. And they require a lot of close monitoring and engagement with governments, not just about those jurisdictional issues, but about, as the industry faces continually, the need to educate governments about the economic and national security importance of cables and their benign environmental nature. So a lot to keep track of. So thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Right on time. But I didn't see the wall for Mexico. The wall? There's no wall? All right, might be already there. I want to acknowledge our sponsors today. So without our sponsors, these things don't happen. And one of our sponsors quite regularly is Suboptic. So in all honesty, I'd love to welcome everybody, please. Eves Regan. Eves is actually the president of the executive committee of Suboptic, also the vice president of Submarine Systems and chairman of Ace Orange. Please make him welcome. better.
Okay, hi everyone. Paul has said, I'm the honor of being the president of the executive committee of Suboptic and other things. And I'd like to say, I'm here to say actually, Happy New Year to Suboptic. Happy New Year to Suboptic because it's a new year for Suboptic. For Suboptic 2017 is born and in a different format than the previous Suboptics. So I'm here to speak shortly about the new Suboptic. Just about what has been done up to now. Suboptic 2016 has been held in Dubai. And it was actually the celebration of the 30th anniversary of the Suboptic concept and conferences. For those who have attended Suboptic in Dubai, you notice that we didn't announce the location, the host for the next Suboptic, which is Suboptic 2019. We didn't do it because we were in a phase of transformation and we wanted to launch a new concept. So this year, 2017, is the year for launching the new Suboptic, which will be a trade association. And I hope that this trade association would at least last for the next 30 years. So this trade association, we wanted to represent the global subsea cable industry. We want to build on the past achievements, of course, which is a conference, a big conference, every 3 years, a very successful one, which is bringing together the subsea community, and which is also encouraging and showcasing the industry research. You know that Suboptic is, and we want to keep it as a very high-level technical conference as well, to really make people understand what's happening in the subsea technology. And this is very important. This is also a reason why we just do it every 3 years. Suboptic has been also expert working groups with results presented at the conferences. I'd like to mention two of them because I think they are very important. In Paris, I think in 2010, the new model construction contract were brought to the public. I think there were two models, one for the consortium cable, one for private cable, in order to help people to design their contract with the supplier. And in Dubai, I think there was also a very good report on the issue of extending the cable lifetime. I think this issue is becoming more and more important when you think about quite a number of cable will reach their end of life in the early 20s. And terminating a cable or making it living a bit more is a very complex issue, actually. And the third part of Suboptic has been our education program, supporting universities. And as an example, I'm writing the guide, which is an introduction to system implementation. So, the new Suboptic. Okay. The new Suboptic is supposed to be even better than the last one, right? Mm-hmm. We hope so. So, one of the big changes is first, a fully open membership. A new association where everyone, all of you, is welcome to join the community as a member. And this is very important. A new constitution has been written for, well, 21st century, at least the beginning. And we decided also to have an event manager, to choose an event manager for the forthcoming suboptic and possibly next ones. And Subtel Forum has been chosen by the executive committee to be the new event manager for suboptic 2019. The last bullet is we will have a new executive committee. We plan to launch a general assembly during ITW 17 in Chicago in May. And this is where the new governance, new people will be elected to govern the new suboptic association. Where will be the next suboptic? This is where suboptic 2019 will be held. You have to give a guess. It's a city, yes. At the seaside, yes. It is in the US. Okay. I'm pleased to announce that Suboptic 2019 will be held in New Orleans. New Orleans is a very exciting, vibrant, and historical city that I'm sure everyone will enjoy. The host, I'm glad to announce that Siena Corporation will be the host of Suboptic 2019. And I'd like to thank very much Siena for the support they will give to this event. The date, write it down in your calendar. It will be 8 to 11 of April 2019. So I think it's also a perfect season for New Orleans. The website is written here, www.suboptic.org. Write it down. It's up and running now. And very soon, I think within the next couple of months, I guess, you will be able to register to become a member of the association. You know everything. Before closing down my presentation, I just would like to thank so much the EC members who have done such a good work during those last years. Maybe those of them who are in the room can stand up. Graham, Jane, I see Masuda-san, Dean, Eric, Alice. So thank you, all of you. Thank you very much for the work you have done. And also I would like to thank all the EC members during the last 30 years who have done those wonderful conferences. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, that brings us to the end of the phase one. Now, which means you can all go and have some coffee and have a relax for a little while. But don't go away, because Elaine will be back here very, very shortly with another exciting investment in phase two. All right? So thank you to the panelists one more time.
Well, it's doom and gloom.